What sets modern civilized history apart from prehistory is that our history is written. We record in writing our progress through time, achievements, and milestones for posterity. The Hammurabi Code, the Ten Commandments, the Bible, the Quran, these are all written records of sacred laws from the ancient world. American democracy, too, has a lineage of written records that show the development of our nation. Each document builds on those before it to make our foundation of freedom stronger. This is Documents of Destiny, the Revolutionary Era. In our program, we have four subject matter experts. Wilson Smith, Professor Emeritus of History, UC Davis.
Well, when we get to the Declaration of Independence, one has to make some generalizations about the background to the men who drew it up. The men who drew it up were, by and large, landed, well-educated colonists.
Priscilla Zadi, Associate Professor of Political Science, United States Naval Academy.
The Constitution is actually written by a number of individuals, and there are certain portions of it that different individuals had a great deal to do with.
Robert George, McCormick Professor of Jurisprudence and Director of the James Madison Program, Princeton University.
After the success of the Revolution, the question arose, what sort of terms of association would the 13 colonies have with each other? Would they function as 13 separate nations, or would they be unified into one nation? And there was sentiment really on both sides.
Pauline Mayer, Professor of History, MIT.
As the Second Continental Congress sat down to debate independence in Philadelphia, the British were arriving off Manhattan, and it must have been a fantastic scene. First 50 ships, then another 50, all coming into the harbor, all coming toward Manhattan with their sails aloft.
The State Constitutions. The success of the American Revolution would see an end to British rule and the need for self-government.
Every man and every body of men on earth possess the right of self-government.
As early as May 1776, the Second Continental Congress urged the colonies to form new state constitutions to replace their royal charters.
State constitutions flourished at the time, and by 1776, 10 states had constitutions. By 1777, 12 did. The first one is the Virginia State Constitution, which is still basically in existence today. Many of these states' constitutions were still in operation after the United States Constitution is passed in 1787.
Of all the new states, only two did not draft new constitutions. They were Connecticut and Rhode Island. Because their 17th century charters had allowed them greater self-government than the other colonies, Connecticut and Rhode Island merely revised their royal charters. From its very beginning, Connecticut in particular had already been experiencing a good deal of political independence. In 1638, English Puritans who first settled the colony adopted the fundamental orders of Connecticut. As spiritual leader Reverend Thomas Hooker would proclaim from the pulpit,
"The foundation of authority is laid in the free consent of the people."
Now, consent again is the whole key here to the contract theory of government between a group of men and whatever governing body they have, whether it's a king, a magistrate, a parliament, a congress, local town government, you name it.
Because colonial Connecticut enjoyed a virtually independent government, Historians describe the fundamental orders as the first written constitution for a representative government. Because of that distinction, Connecticut adopted the nickname the Constitution State. Despite the differences of the various states, the state constitutions are remarkably similar.
They're great documents to read because they are precursors to many of the ideas that exist in the U.S. Constitution. Most of them have bicameral legislatures, they have executive branches, they have judicial branches, they have a Bill of Rights. In fact, the Virginia Constitution, its Bill of Rights that's added to that document occurs 3 weeks before the Declaration of Independence is read.
In May 1776, George Mason penned the Virginia Declaration of Rights. In Mason's words, we can hear concepts that 2 months later found their way into the Declaration of Independence.
A Declaration of Rights made by the representatives of the good people of Virginia, that all men are by nature equally free and independent and have certain inherent rights, that all power is vested in and derived from the people, that government is instituted for the common benefit, protection, and security of the people, nation, or community.
Although founded on Republican ideals, the state constitutions had their limitations, especially with regard to the fundamental natural right of equality. For one thing, the right to vote was not universal. The constitutions reserved the right to vote or hold office to white men who owned property. The men of Revolutionary America denied the rights of citizenship to colonial women. They could not vote, could not hold office, and could not even own property, except as widows. Although some northern state constitutions or court decisions provided for slave emancipation, most of the new states, including all of those in the South, excluded African American slaves from exercising their natural rights as human beings. Nevertheless, these experiments in self-government later enabled African Americans to demand their freedom, leading to an American democracy that better fulfilled its founding principles. Although equality remained elusive, in time, white Americans recognized their obligations to extend freedom to all, to fulfill the ideals envisioned by the founders. The Virginia Statute for Religious Freedom. As states formed their own constitutions, one of their many concerns was the influence that the church had on government. Prior to the Revolution, most colonies, like Virginia, used tax money to support one established denomination. That favored church varied from region to region. In New England, the colonies favored the Congregational Church. In the southern and in some of the middle colonies, the Church of England, or Anglican Church, enjoyed the privileges of establishment. Those privileges offended the many colonists who either belonged to another church or to no church at all. During the Revolution, Thomas Jefferson was among those who opposed close ties between the government and any particular religion. A basic tenet of American freedom is the right to worship as we please. Jefferson argued for this right when, as governor of Virginia, he wrote the Virginia Statute for Religious Freedom, which established the separation of church and state. The roots of these concepts go back to the very beginning of our country.
Underlying a number of these documents, when you go back to the Mayflower Compacts, you go back to things like the Massachusetts Bay Charter, many of these states were concerned about religious persecution as well. I mean, Winthrop is a Puritan and felt like there had to be a good moral community. Of course, then the question is who gets to decide what is that moral community. But there is a religious undertone here of rights. Locke himself was deeply religious, was trained as a Puritan or raised as a Puritan as a child. So there was a religious undertone to this as far as liberties and freedoms that should be secured against a government. So Jefferson does pen these declarations of religious freedom, which clearly you can see in the Constitution, the Bill of Rights. When you look at what is the First Amendment today, which was penned as the Third Amendment, is the idea of the right of freedom of religion and freedom against an established religion.
George Mason, in his statutes of Virginia Bill of Rights, can be contrasted with Jefferson's bill on religious freedom in Virginia. Jefferson was concerned with a total separation of church from state. Mason was more interested in the Lockean idea of the individual self, the reasoning person being free and at liberty to have his natural rights preserved. So there was not the religious tenor to Mason's document that was present, of course, in Jefferson's. Not because Jefferson was thrusting a religious sentiment upon anyone in that document. In his, he was trying to keep religion separate from the power of the state.
Thomas Paine's Common Sense. During the first year of the American Revolution, not everyone in the 13 colonies believed that we should become a self-governing country, independent from England. Those who opposed independence were called loyalists, meaning that they were loyal to England. Their motives for loyalty differed. Some loyalists honored their oaths of allegiance to the crown. They believed that to break their oaths and resist the king was to dishonor God. Some were colonial leaders who feared losing power and wealth in a revolutionary war. Some were Indians who feared losing their lands to the American revolutionaries. Others were African American slaves who sought freedom by helping the British forces. But most were common Americans who worried that the violent upheaval of a revolution would destroy law and order. Although loyalists could be found in substantial numbers in most of the colonies, more colonists felt that they could never accept the restoration of British rule. Independence became more popular as the best solution to the crisis, and they had the support of great statesmen and legendary patriots like Patrick Henry and Thomas Paine. Patrick Henry dramatically fueled that flame with his historic speech to the Virginia Committee of Correspondence.
Gentlemen may cry, peace, peace, but there is no peace. The war is actually begun. Is life so dear or peace so sweet as to be purchased at the price of chains and slavery? Forbid it, Almighty God. I know not what course others may take, but as for me, give me liberty or give me death.
But if Patrick Henry first spoke of independence, it was Thomas Paine who created a groundswell of popular support when in January 1776 he published his widely read pamphlet, Common Sense.
Thomas Paine, in his document, The Common Sense, calls for that, calls for an absolute break from Great Britain, that there could be no relationship, that they could not continue on as a colony. So the significance by 1775 is that most individuals in the colony began to believe that the only thing they could do was absolutely create their own government.
Paine was arguing in favor of freedom and against the crown, against the king, against the authority of the king. He certainly disbelieved in anything even remotely approaching the divine right of kings. He was quite religiously skeptical, as a matter of fact.
Thomas Paine attacked British rule while promoting the rights of Americans to independence.
Society in every state is a blessing, but government, even in its best state, is a necessary evil. In its worst state, an intolerable one.
Paine was a fiery writer and a great, ardent advocate of liberty. He frequently got himself into trouble by his flights of rhetoric because free speech was not cherished as much then as it is now. But of course, he was a fiery enemy of excessive government power, and that made him a friend of the American revolutionaries.
150,000 copies of Common Sense sold in a matter of months. 500,000 of the pamphlets sold in total. Although many Americans remained loyalists, Common Sense helped create a majority that favored independence. In July of 1776, this majority challenged the Continental Congress to adopt the Declaration of Independence. Thomas Paine's role in American history cannot be overstated. John Adams put it this way:
without the pen of Paine, the sword of Washington would have been wielded in vain.
The Declaration of Independence. On June 7, 1776, Richard Henry Lee of Virginia introduced a resolution in the Second Continental Congress proclaiming independence for the colonies.
Resolved that these united colonies are and of right ought to be free and independent states.
A five-member committee that included Thomas Jefferson was assembled to draft a formal Declaration of Independence. And on July 4, 1776, Congress formally adopted the Declaration, and the United States of America became a nation independent of Britain. Although Thomas Jefferson received credit for composing this masterful document, he received invaluable help from the writings of Richard Henry Lee, George Mason, and political philosophers who came before him, mainly John Locke.
Where we most clearly see the influence of Locke in the American founding documents is in the Declaration of Independence. Of course, it was written by Thomas Jefferson. And Jefferson says in the most famous passage of the Declaration that we hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal, that they are endowed by their Creator with certain unalienable rights, and among these are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. Locke had famously identified the basic rights that we have as human beings as being the rights to life, liberty, and property. So we see Locke's influence very clearly here, although the term property is laid aside, and Jefferson substitutes the phrase the pursuit of happiness. I think what's going on here is that Jefferson is really broadening the concept that Locke had in mind. I mean, the pursuit of happiness would include property, but wouldn't necessarily be simply restricted to it. I also think it's true that Jefferson wanted to avoid some of the connotations that the term property might have had in those days as suggesting a link with feudal rights and so forth. But the key thing to see is that Locke's influence is being felt very keenly in that phrase, life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness.
Although Jefferson borrowed and distilled the ideals of many great thinkers before him, his eloquence made the Declaration of Independence this nation's most treasured expression of our ideals.
The first paragraph of the Declaration is in some ways the most novel. We remember the second paragraph, but the first paragraph begins when in the course of human events it becomes necessary for one people to dissolve the political bands which have connected with them with another. Compare that to most similar documents, the English Declaration of Rights, for example, or the preamble to the Virginia Constitution, which the state of Virginia had adopted only a few weeks earlier. They begin, whereas. The drama is much greater. And I think of what those words must have meant, for example, to American soldiers to whom the Declaration was read on Manhattan. They may have felt that they were just another underfinanced, undermanned army about to be destroyed by the greatest military power in the world. And the Declaration arrives that says, this is an event of significance in human history. And it is an event, as the last line went on to say, that mankind will be interested. A decent respect for the opinions of mankind demands that we declare the causes of this separation. it put the whole event on a much more heroic level.
The Declaration of Independence announced to the world that Americans had suffered from the abusive government of King George III and that the Americans were ready to establish their own representative government. For the people of Jefferson's time, this was the important message. They weren't as interested in the eloquently worded ideals.
The ideals stated in the second paragraph of the Declaration of Independence were commonplace, which is one reason that contemporaries didn't pay very much attention to the second paragraph, which is always very surprising for modern Americans. We remember only the opening lines of the second paragraph, the lines that begin, "We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal, that they are endowed by their Creator with certain inalienable rights, among which are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness." Those lines were stated in other places. For example, the Virginia Declaration of Rights is an obvious precedent. I have a sermon. I came across a sermon in Massachusetts from May 1776 that says pretty much the same thing. I think contemporaries regarded that as eloquent boilerplate. When they quoted the Declaration of Independence, what they cited almost inevitably was the last paragraph. The last paragraph, which most people today hardly remember, but it is the part that makes the declaration that gave the document its name. It declares these United Colonies free and independent states. What was new in 1776 was independence.
For more than 200 years, Americans have celebrated July 4th as their Independence Day. Today we celebrate with fireworks and displays of the flag. It was pretty much the same from the very beginning.
As the Declaration of Independence is read to gatherings of people in small rural towns or major seaports, there were enormous expressions of joy. And I think this makes some sense. You must remember that these people had been at war with Great Britain for over a year without formally absolving their obligations of loyalty. Suddenly they felt they were involved in a consistent effort. As one soldier said, now hand and heart can move together. So there were great celebrations. They shouted, they huzzaed, they threw their hats in the air. The other traditional way of celebrating occasions like this was to put candles in windows. They're called illuminations. The militia would march, they'd fire off guns. Some people would say that's a terrible waste of ammunition, but they would do it here and there anyway. But mostly there were the readings of the Declaration itself.
The Articles of Confederation. After victory in the War of the American Revolution, the political leaders debated what kind of union they should and could have with one another. Should it be a centralized nation or a loose confederation of 13 sovereign states? There was sentiment on both sides. Some insisted that only a strong union could provide effective government, but others feared that a strong national government would dominate and exploit the common people. In 1781, the states ratified their first collective constitution, the Articles of Confederation, which established a loose confederation that lacked the power to levy its own taxes or to regulate commerce.
And the Articles of Confederation were terms of government, what we might call a constitution, although they didn't use that name, a constitution under which the states would be associated with each other. There would be certain powers that the central government would have, but very, very limited powers and quite a loose association.
In 1776, the Second Continental Congress gave the responsibility for drafting the Articles of Confederation to a committee led by John Dickinson, the patriot and constitutional expert from Delaware. The committee also included Benjamin Franklin, one of America's revered elder statesmen. The delegates from the 13 states distrusted one another, but Franklin's presence had a calming effect on the proceedings in Congress.
People disagreed about what the structure of the new government should be. There was some suspicion about motives. people from the small states and people from the large states didn't see eye to eye on some issues. How would power be allocated? Would the small states' interests be protected, or because they were smaller in population, would their interests be given less weight?
The powers granted to the federal government in the Articles of Confederation were specific and few. They included the authority to borrow and coin money, to conduct foreign diplomacy and war, and to settle disputes between the states. In general, however, the states refused to give up their sovereignty and power. So the Confederation government proved too weak to cope with the foreign and domestic crises of the 1780s.
The Articles of Confederation are a first attempt at some structural central government, but they ultimately fail because they do not really create much of a central government at all. There was no executive. There was no judicial branch. All amendments had to be passed unanimously by the states. There was no form of raising revenue. Everyone was to donate if they wanted to, and you can imagine how little money they raised doing that. There was no national or systemic defense system, so they ultimately proved very unworkable.
I would look at three areas where people had concerns about the insufficiency of the authority of the national government under the Articles of Confederation. One of these was economics, particularly in the area of trade. With the loose affiliation of the Articles of Confederation, the states were free to tax goods that were produced in other states. They were free to set up tariffs and barriers to trade to try to protect their own local farms and industries. This was disastrous from an economic point of view. So something had to be done to create free trade, really, among the several states. So sentiment arose to forbid the states from taxing each other's goods, or at least taxing them in a discriminatory way, from erecting tariffs and barriers to trade and so forth. Another area was in the area of a domestic order. Having a national government that would be strong enough to ensure that the states weren't actually fighting with each other. And then the third area would be in the area of foreign affairs, to have a national government that would enable the United States to protect itself against foreign enemies, and a government that would be strong enough to take its rightful place among the family of nations.
By 1787, most Americans recognized that the Articles of Confederation were too weak to provide an effective union of the states.
In view of these concerns on the economic and domestic and foreign affairs front, sentiment arose for a stronger constitution, a constitution with a stronger national government.
And the framers quickly realized this. By 1787 in May, they meet in Annapolis to reconsider the Articles of Confederation, to alter them. They don't have a quorum. They meet in September in Philadelphia. And the first order of business really is the most interesting. Within days, they admit what they're going to do is scrap the Articles of Confederation and begin anew and write a constitution. So one of the first things that happens in Philadelphia is the writing of a new constitution.
Although the Articles of Confederation failed to establish a strong central government, it was a necessary first step that led up to the drafting of the United States Constitution in 1787. American independence had been achieved. The next great challenge was for this loose confederation to come together as one nation. In Volume 3 of Documents of Destiny, we'll look at the United States Constitution, the Bill of Rights, the Federalist Papers, and George Washington's farewell address.